Carl Earl Lucas grew up in Harlem, New York, where he often got into trouble with the law, along with his best friend, Willis Stryker, who later became skillful in using blades, while Lucas was always formidable in hand-to-hand combat, since he never liked using guns, which both of them would go on to be leaders in the Bloods gang. Subsequently, a life of crime began to take a toll on Lucas, as he no longer wanted to live that lifestyle. However, Stryker did, while making it big in the local rackets, which eventually got him in trouble with the syndicate mob, which Stryker's new girlfriend, Reva Connors, who Stryker and Lucas were prior in a friendly competition to see who could date her first, came running to Lucas, desperately needing his help to save Stryker, which Lucas, without a second thought, rushed to his friend's aid, taking on and taking down the hitman that stood no chance against him. Before Stryker was next hospitalized for his injuries, and shockingly turned on Lucas, who he felt manipulated Reva into no longer agreeing with his lifestyle. Ironically, Lucas would eventually start dating Reva to the point they would start discussing marriage, which Stryker would take notice of. So he later framed Lucas by planting narcotics in his home before next informing the authorities, which ended up getting Lucas sentenced to 15 years in prison. So Stryker next tried to get his girl back by pretending to want to help her get Lucas out of jail. Meanwhile, there was a bounty on his life after he stole a shipment of drugs from drug smugglers, which inadvertently got Reva killed, causing Stryker to lose control of the vehicle they were in and drove off a cliff, which Stryker surprisingly survived. Moreover, Lucas heard the bad news when he was sent to Seagate Maximum Security Prison, also known as Little Alcatraz, on an island off the southeast coast, after many brawls and attempted escape from his prior institution, which added 3 more years to his sentence, as he now lived to seek revenge on Stryker. Unfortunately, even his parole hearings ended in aggression, so Lucas remained a loner, but still highly respected by a lot of inmates, like Comanche and Shades. To the point, the captain of the facility, Billy Bob Rackham, wanted to use him as an informant to spy on his fellow convicts, who were plotting a demonstration on a new warden, which would gain Captain Rackham a lot of admiration if he unraveled a plot against the new warden. Unsurprisingly, Lucas refused, which angered the captain, who sent him back to solitary confinement, where he would continue to be harassed and physically abused by Deputy Court and his crew in an unusual way in his attempts to make Lucas obedient. Fortunately for Lucas, the new warden, Mr. Tyler Stewart, purposely arrived unannounced to witness the unlawful act and proceeded to fire Deputy Court on the spot, but not before locking him in with Lucas in solitary confinement for 10 minutes to teach him a lesson on humility, which Lucas then took that opportunity to exact his revenge. Following this, Captain Rackham would be demoted to a regular correctional officer. Thereafter, Lucas would later be visited by Dr. Noah Burstein to voluntarily join his medical project that requires a healthy, strong man for his research grant from Stark Industries. However, Lucas would initially refuse, but eventually give in after Rackham promised to make his life a living hell. So Lucas took his chances, since entering the program would influence the parole board and releasing him early. So Lucas underwent the risky and extremely painful experiment that prior cost many their lives in the seldom used section of the prison in order to try to help mankind by countering the damage of any disease when he was put in an electrobiochemical system machine for stimulating human cell regeneration. Disturbingly, however, Rackham would sneak his way in and purposely twist a dial, soaring the power level to dangerous heights, causing Lucas to endure excruciating pain as the machine Lucas was in reached maximum overload and eventually exploded. Astoundingly, Lucas would survive, but now with solid muscles and weighing 300 pounds, looking like he only weighs 180, while having skin like iron and fists that could break stone, which he went on to slap Rackham unconscious with, then believing he accidentally killed him. So out of frustration, feeling he was now never going to get out of prison, he punched and chipped the prison wall. Seeing this, Lucas continued to break through the wall in order to escape so he didn't have to face new charges. Unsurprisingly, Lucas would later be shot multiple times with shotgun rounds by the prison guards, causing him to plunge down into a deep, dark river after falling off a cliff. Shockingly, Lucas would resurface yards away with only minor bruises from the gunshots, while next staking out until nightfall, waiting for the guards to call off their search, which they would eventually do, while officially declaring Lucas deceased. Furthermore, Lucas would discover an abandoned canoe he would use to sail to mainland. Unfortunately later, Warden Stewart would be released from his duties by the state prison board over the incident. Meanwhile, Lucas would begin his long journey that would take months to make his way north to New York while working small jobs that didn't require identification and suppressing the use of his powers, so he doesn't draw attention. Further down the line, he would inadvertently stop a robber of a diner, which gained him a cash reward from the owner of Ace Diner, who next gave him the idea to make a living out of helping people. But not before Lucas visited Reva's gravesite and came up with his new alias, Luke Cage, a name created in part from his old name and memories of prison bars and cold stone walls, as he finally made it to Harlem, where he immediately went on to check out scenes and sources from his past to connect a trail to find Stryker, who was unbeknownst to him, now going by the name Diamondback, since he can strike swiftly like a snake using his blades, and surprisingly also, he was now a small leader in the syndicate mob. So Luke Cage, now wearing a secondhand outfit that once belonged to escape artist, which Luke Cage brought from a Theater District costume shop while adding a headband along with a steel chain to go around his waist for his new job of being a mercenary. And after, a box full of business cards labeled Hero for Hire, since he figured people hire security guards and private detectives, so why not make a living in what he now does, as he went on to promote himself by cleaning the streets of criminal scumbags, then passing out his business card to citizen onlookers. Ironically, Diamondback would send a hit squad after him, after Luke Cage was inadvertently taking out his goons and affecting his business. By next meeting, Dr. Claire Temple and shockingly, Dr. Noah Burstein, who both ran a storefront clinic together. And after Noah figured out Luke Cage was actually Lucas. Moreover, Luke Cage would now be living and working on West 42nd Street between Broadway and 8th Avenue on the third floor of the Jim Movie Theater, where his new living office would be located at. Thereafter, Diamondback and his men would abduct Claire Temple at gunpoint in order to coerce Luke Cage and meeting them at a building garage, which Luke Cage, with suspicion, were obliged to, inevitably walking into an ambush, fighting and taking down Diamondback's men, before revealing his true identity to Diamondback himself, as they next engaged in combat, with Diamondback hitting Luke Cage with a special made sonic wave blade, created by the resident genius who went by the nickname Gadget. And next, almost hitting Luke Cage with a blade equipped with a cartridge that possibly had either mace or cyanide gas in it. Nevertheless, Luke Cage would withstand every attack Diamondback threw at him, to the point Diamondback, out of fear and desperation, accidentally sealed his fate when he backed up and fell through the parking garage rooftop window, one short level down, before his final blade, equipped with explosive, landed on its activation point next to him and detonated, killing him and finally ending his reign of terror. Following this, Dr. Noah would be indecisive on if he should turn Luke Cage over to authorities or let him roam free unsupervised, but decided to just keep tabs on him so he doesn't go the criminal route. Inevitably later, Luke Cage, who was accompanied by his new associate, the nephew of the owner of the movie theater, Dave Griffith, better known as DW, would get his first unexpected client in the form of Owen Ridgely, a United States veteran who was on the run from the bitter and outraged, forced to retire U.S. Army Colonel Gideon Mace and his men after he tried to recruit Owen in a violent act of protest against the American government by first attacking Manhattan Island's bridge, tunnels, and power stations for an entire day with explosive and assault rifles deployed by his combat soldiers and specialized strike teams, all because for the way the government treats its veterans. Unsurprisingly, Gideon's men tracked down Owens at Luke Cage's office and tried to use DW as a hostage decoy to get to him. Nonetheless, Luke Cage seen through the ploy and attacked the hitman, with brute and might delivering crushing blows to the would-be assassins. However, Gideon's men were one step ahead of Luke Cage when they had one of their men come through the back up the fire escape, assassinating Owen with a barrage of bullets from an M3 submachine gun. Sadly, Owen would pass away, but not before giving Luke Cage his payment to take down Gideon Mace, which Luke Cage wouldn't disappoint when he later used a vehicle to crash through Gideon Mace's place of residence and proceeded to put the hurt business on Gideon's men. Whereupon, Gideon, who had a steel ball with spikes attached to his hand as his iron mace, customized to also shoot out chemical mace after he lost his hand during war and went on to train himself to master the weapon for 6 years of intense training, 3 hours each day, now using his skills against Luke Cage before making his escape to his awaiting helicopter while trying to stop the pursuing Luke Cage with a hand grenade, which only momentarily delayed the inevitable. And that's Luke Cage sending his whole operation crashing down, causing the helicopter to plunge into the Hudson River, where Gideon was out of his element since he never trained himself how to swim with his iron mace, causing him to sink into the dark, murky depths to his final resting place. Thereafter, Luke Cage and the Honorable Jester will go on and donate his payment to Owen's now widowed wife. Succeeding this, the renowned and persistent Broadway columnist from the Daily Bugle, Phil Fox, will take an interest in Luke Cage, wanted to tell his story, which Luke Cage wasn't fond of the unwanted attention. Moreover, Luke Cage would encounter and battle the Haitian strongman Jacques Sassis and his masked acrobatic partner Armin Lauren that were from Herbert's Miracle Circus Museum across the street from the Jim Movie Theater after a wealthy franchise businessman Jasper Burnt, who owns a chain of movie theaters, hired Luke Cage to stop the unknown culprits at the time that were after a portrait of the prior business owner Adrian Lauren at the Jim Movie Theater, which it was later revealed Jasper was his business partner, secretly embezzling him out of earnings, and next murdering him in an office fire in order to have full control of the movie chains. Shockingly, it will also be revealed Armin Lauren was Adrian Lauren's long-lost son, who was in prison in Haiti and now out to get his father's killer. Subsequently, Luke Cage discovered the truth about the portrait after finding papers between his canvas and frame, proving Armin was indeed Adrian Long's son and heir to his father's share of the chain of theaters. Unfortunately, in a murder-suicide, Armin sent Jasper and himself crashing out the third floor window to their death. As time progressed, Luke Cage would get his first female client, Mrs. Jenks, that he decided not to charge after her husband, a gambling addict, was murdered in his office and his body next stolen by men disguised as paramedics, working for the female crime boss, Black Mariah, who ran a profitable and illegal operation that specialized in rapidly stealing the corpse of the deceased, who perished in public places, so they could quickly take possession of all their valuables. Having said that, Luke Cage took on her men, including the massive and physically dangerous Black Mariah herself at her warehouse on 17th near 18th, before she tried to escape in her stolen speedboat, which didn't go as planned, since Luke Cage damaged and sank it with her on it before handing her over to authorities. Moving on from this, Luke Cage would start dating Claire Temple, and next get hired by a couple of rich white sisters named Laura and Catherine Forsyth, who was recommended by Noah to seek out Luke Cage so he could protect their dying grandfather, Raymond, who was suffering from the polio virus while having countless murder attempts on his life from an unknown assailant that was later revealed by Luke Cage to be Robert Frederick Forsyth, the grandson of Raymond, that was thought dead but was actually alive and now after his grandfather's estate before he turns 25 in 2 days, which would disqualify him from the inheritance. So after Luke Cage solved another case, he was handsomely rewarded with a bonus double cheek kiss, which Clara wasn't fond of. Moreover, Luke Cage would be visited by another wealthy individual for a job, which Luke Cage would initially refuse, until said individual offered him $200 a day if he could find and capture 4 men who stole his boss's company secrets. So Luke Cage took the case and made his way to Bedford Stuyvesant with descriptions and a phone number to call after he's done. Nonetheless, Luke Cage would track the culprits down within 5 hours in Bed-Stuy, unleashing his world-famous beatdown when he suddenly came to find out the men were robots. So Luke Cage, not unsure of what he was getting himself into, decided to have a word with his employer, who he tracked down an hour later at the Latvian embassy up First Avenue, when suddenly he was confronted by Dr. Victor Von Doom, better known as Dr. Doom, the ruler of the European country of Latveria, who explained to Luke Cage that the robots he encountered were his rogue droids that fled to America and disguised themselves as African Americans to hide out. So Luke Cage continued the job he was hired for and headed back out to Bed-Stuy, where he would be ambushed by the robots who spotted him in an intense battle for his life as he felt pain coursing through his body from their sledgehammer blows, which the toughness of his skin couldn't save his organs from bursting inside. Unsurprisingly, Luke Cage would go on to turn each one of them into a twisted wreck of scrap metal. Shockingly after, Luke Cage would find out Dr. Doom closed his embassy to depart back to his home country without paying Luke Cage, which Luke Cage wouldn't take lightly, as he next made his way to the Baxter Building, home of the Fantastic Four, dropping Ben Grimm, also known as the Thing, on his back in the process, so he could request a rocket from their leader, Reed Richards, better known as Mr. Fantastic, and fly to Latveria before he was eventually subdued by the team. Surprisingly afterwards, Reed Richards would grant Luke Cage's request after hearing his motives and already knowing Luke Cage's character after reading about him in the newspaper for being honest and honorable with a whole lot of courage and determination added. So when Luke Cage finally made it to Latveria an hour later, he quickly took on Dr. Doom's soldiers while surprisingly being joined by a herd of more robots who were part of the revolt against Dr. Doom as they swiftly went on to take down the outer defense together, which helped Luke Cage to finally be able to confront the man who owed him $200 for an honest day's work, which Dr. Doom found crazy. Luke Cage traveled all the way to Latveria for a small debt that was denied to him, Nevertheless, Luke Cage would attack Dr. Doom, and after a series of repeated strategic hits, focusing on one point of Dr. Doom's armor that was forged to withstand anything except that, caused the stress to render his main weapon's power circuits inoperative. Afterwards, Luke Cage would earn Dr. Doom's respect and finally get paid for what he's owed before heading back home. Furthermore, Luke Cage will battle and defeat the Puerto Rican crime boss, Mr. Luck, Senor Suerte, also known as Mr. Death, Senor Muerte, who was responsible for the death of Frank Jinks, who wanted to quit gambling while trying to bring Senor Muerte's whole operation down by trying to hire Luke Cage. Moreover, Senor Muerte used the dial on his chest to charge any one of his hand with a powerful death dialing voltage to end Luke Cage in a game of Russian roulette, which he finally lost for the first time in his life in an intense second round that will permanently end his life at his private casino, when Luke Cage used his belt chain to wrap around Senor Muerte's hands as an electric current. Furthermore, elsewhere, Phil Fox would break in the Square Clinic, where he would steal Dr. Noah's diary records of the experiments at Seagate Prison, which he would discover Luke Cage was actually an escaped convict. So Phil Fox decided to use that information to blackmail Luke Cage. Meanwhile, the editor-in-chief of the Daily Bugle, J. Jonah Jameson, would hire Luke Cage for $5,000 to capture Spider-Man, dead or alive, for the supposed murder of his friend and fellow financier, the wealthy industrialist Norman Osborn, which Luke Cage would happily agree to, and go on to track down Spidey, delivering steel fists and kicks, not letting up one bit against the swift wall crawler, who was tougher than he looked, and had a bad attitude after the death of Gwen Stacy. Moreover, Spidey would temporarily stop Luke Cage in their first confrontation, but not before making it personal, after insulting him as a cheap third-rate thug for charging citizens in order to help them. Soon thereafter, their second confrontation will end at a school concert, where once again Spidey managed to subdue him with his spider web, and go on to explain his side of the story, which several hours later, Luke Cage will make his way to the Daily Bugle to J. Jonah Jameson's office and refund him his money, no longer wanting to take the case. Succeeding this, Phil Fox will confront Luke Cage about his past, and demand he rob a bank for him if he didn't want to go back to prison, which to Phil Fox's dismay, Luke Cage immediately rejected his proposition and threatened to break him in half for disrespecting his character, which caused Phil Fox to flee in panic before he bumped into Claire Temple outside while insulting the name of Luke Cage, which earned him a mighty slap. Succeeding this, Luke Cage would be hired by the mayor of New York to defeat Senor Alejandro Cortez, a school teacher and circus performer, now calling himself Lion Fang, after inventing a helmet that had limited thought transferal but was rejected by the school board, so Long Fang used the technology on his pet lion, tiger, and panther to seek revenge on the school board. However, during a battle with Luke Cage, he was accidentally killed. Furthermore, Luke Cage's former fellow inmates, Comanche and Shades, escaped from Seagate Prison and now were seeking revenge against Rackham after many years of torture because they were known affiliates of Luke Cage. But Rackham inevitably got fired for brutality when the fired old warden, Stewart, managed to get the state prison board to investigate the happenings in the facility. So now, the two escaped convicts had tracked down Rackham in New York after a month-long search, and next got themselves a couple of costumes to disguise themselves. Ironically, Phil Fox would get his chance to interview Rackham after he showed up at the Daily Bugle looking to put an advertisement for a job position. Shockingly, Phil Fox would reveal to Rackham that Carl Lucas was indeed alive and a superhero now going by Luke Cage, which Rackham is partially responsible for, while next being convinced to join him into blackmailing Luke Cage, but this time with Rackham's suggestion to abduct Luke Cage's girlfriend Claire Temple instead. However, later, Rackham mistakenly abducted Mrs. Jenks, confusing her identity with Claire, leading to Rackham viciously attacking her to the disapproval of Phil Fox. As beforehand, at Luke Cage's office, Mrs. Jenks, intoxicated 330-pound of muscle business lawyer, Big Ben Donovan, came crashing in looking for her after his failed prior advancements. So in a drunken fit of rage, he began to attack Luke Cage, thinking she preferred him instead. Unsurprisingly, Luke Cage would get the upper hand and beat Big Ben into submission. Furthermore, Claire Temple would discover Phil Fox's murdered body in Mrs. Jenks' apartment after she thought Luke Cage was cheating on her. But now, Claire, who prior heard an argument and a gunshot before entering, was now at the center of a homicide investigation, with her being the prime suspect. Meanwhile, Rackham, who accidentally shot and killed Phil Fox, sped off in Phil Fox's car, with his captive in the back seat, to New Jersey to hide out. Moreover, Luke Cage would call in Big Ben Donovan for a favor to take on Claire Temple's criminal case pro bono. Thereafter, during Luke Cage's investigation, he will encounter Shades and Comanche at Harlem's largest liquor store chain, extorting them for protection money, So he went on to attack them before confronting his street informant, nicknamed Flea, who secretly knew what was going on, but didn't tell him. However, he would clear things up, and Shades, along with Comanche, would then convince Luke Cage to join their protection racket in order for them to keep his secret secret, while also helping him find and rescue Mrs. Jenks, which would simultaneously be the key in freeing Claire Temple, which Luke Cage would eventually agree to. Succeeding this, Luke Cage and his comrades would track down Rackham at a ranch in the suburbs, when suddenly a loud explosion rocked the residence, bringing down the roof on everyone inside. Luckily, everyone survived, until Rackham opened fire with a revolver, hitting Mrs. Jenks 3 times, causing the house to rattle, making more heavy debris to come crashing down, ironically only on Rackham, which knocked him unconscious. Surprisingly after, the man behind the explosion would reveal himself to be Thomas Stewart, also known as the Leto, the son of the old Warden Stewart, out for revenge. Nevertheless, Luke Cage would prove to be too much for him. So after an intense battle, the Leto made his escape. Meanwhile, Rackham would awaken and go into panic mode after hearing sirens, which caused him to blindly run into the streets, only to fatally get struck by a Russian ambulance. Following this, Shades and Comanche would be apprehended by the authorities, while remaining silent about Luke Cage's true identity. Moreover, Mrs. Jenks would sadly succumb to her injuries, but not before revealing to the authorities what really happened at her apartment, which after cleared Claire Temple of all charges. As time progressed, Luke Cage would change his operation name from Hero for Hire to Power Man, after feeling the prior title gave him no publicity.